Hello everybody, it's Adam again. So I just want to bring up something somebody said in my previous video. There was a little bit of confusion regarding whether or not I was making reference to Catholicism or some type of thing. Look, it's not about religion. I want to address the body of Christ, the spiritual body, the ecclesia, the invisible church. I don't believe in a physical church being manifested on this earth unless it be the actual kingdom of God and the Lord's Prayer. So I just want to make that clear. And right now, I want to go through some revelation regarding the body and the blood of Christ. Because what we know as what we think is a physical thing is way more than what we could have ever imagined. And so I don't know how much you've read the Bible. Maybe you haven't read enough. Maybe you haven't read any at all. Maybe you're knowing quite a bit, but maybe you haven't really touched on the reality of the wisdom, you know, the oil that the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord God in heaven, has provided. Should we have the understanding, or should we seek and we will find? So asking and receiving, here is the answer. So, according to the book of John, Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. And furthermore, I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If any man eat of this bread, he shall live forever, and the bread I will give is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. Now I'm going to move on to Matthew. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to the disciples and said, take, eat, this is my body. What we get to know here in this revelation is that Jesus Christ, his body is the bread of life. He is the bread of life. So when we talk about this sacrament of the bread, a lot of people have this, okay, there's a belief that the bread of Christ is his literal body, like we're actually eating his flesh. It's a spiritual thing, symbolic. I mean, it's not like we're not cannibals. Jesus was talking about how if you eat his flesh and you drink his blood, you will be risen at the last day. And a lot of people had this idea because they had natural understanding, like a Pharisee or a scribe. They could not perceive the fabric, the framework of our reality, of our existence. That man is not justified by sight, but by faith. And so Jesus was hoping that the people would all have this Nicodemus revelation, where they would get to know what it means to be born again. So when I bring up the word Pharisee, I'm going to show you this right here. And what do you think, right? You got the see in there, like the all-seeing eye. Very interesting. You know, Satan is the god of this world and he's blinded this world. So you get an understanding of why people are the way that they are, why they think in a natural understanding without the spirit. So the thing is, when Jesus Christ came to this earth, he had a spiritual understanding. He already knew things that the normal average man would not know. So this Catholic Church is a good example of the Pharisees. They are the Pharisees. They perceive that it's a physical thing. He answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth from the mouth of God. If we go further in John, Jesus said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, Moses gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he that which cometh down from heaven and giveth life unto the world. So this bread is not just who he is, but it's what he's about, you know? And so he's the Word of God. The Word of God is the bread of life. Man will not live by bread alone. If I go further to Deuteronomy, it says, and this is in the Old Testament, just to clarify, we were only quoting New Testament scripture. This is Moses right here. And he humbled thee and suffered thee to hunger and fed thee manna, which thou knewest not, neither did thy fathers know, that he might make thee know that man doth not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of the Lord doth man live. And the thing is, if you go further, you get to understand that the people ate the manna, but they were dead. They were spiritually, they weren't, it was a carnal thing. So carnality is not what life is. You cannot live solely in the carnal. Man will not live by carnality alone, but by spirit, which is life and truth and love, you know, because Jesus taught us that it's love that is the essence of what it means, what the things that we do and all these things. God is love. You know, we're an embodiment of Him. It's like, you know, for me, worship, you know, all these participations with God, all these things we do with Him, it's a union. It's all about unity and all of this. But it's really, it can't be done with the carnality. It's we need to extend past the carnality. We need to be properly yoked, you know. His yoke is easy and His burden is light. We need to be yoked up with God. Anybody who's not a part of that yoke, we can't be fellowshipping with. I know I'm going all kinds of different directions, but the thing is, we're not to be unequally yoked. Don't have fellowship with darkness. God divide the light from the darkness. I mentioned this in my previous video. In the beginning was the Word. This is the book of John. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory, the glory as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. So Jesus Christ is the Word of God. This is Colossians, giving thanks unto the Father, which hath made us meet to be partakers of the inheritance of the saints in light, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness, and hath translated us into the kingdom of His dear Son, in whom we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sins. When I hear this passage, I say He's translated us. It's very interesting. You know, it's as He's the Word of God, it's like we become like words. You know, we become an extension of who He is. We become a part of His family. We become partakers. We won't even be speaking English anymore, it seems, because back in the Tower of Babel, if you go back in the Old Testament, this was right after the flood. Everybody came together in one accord in the book of Genesis, and this was the Tower of Babel. The people tried to create this one world religion, this one world unity, you know, and the thing is that they wanted to build a tower to heaven. They wanted to conquer. They wanted to go and basically kill God. And the thing is that God confounded their language. He confused them, and they all got divided and dispersed across the world. And so this new world order that you know today is just them coming back and reuniting and getting back together from all these different cultures and ethnicities, religions and such. So the people were brought back together so that they could fulfill their agenda once again. As the scriptures have spoken, this corruption, you know, this unholy mingling of light and darkness. Now I'm going to go to Matthew. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, drink ye all of it, for this is the blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. Now this is John. Whosoever eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is meat indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. We are receiving the sacrifice, the blood sacrifice of Him. This is Paul's words. Some try to say Paul is a liar. This is the Word of God. For the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's what it truly means, that we have partaking in God, who is Spirit, and we receive what He has done for us. And so we become unified with that, and we manifest the fruits, all these fruits of the Spirit. And so if I go forward, Luke, it says, neither shall they say, lo here or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. So important. But there's, you know, false doctrines where people start believing that because God is inside them, they are God. That's why we have what they call the New Age movement. We have this Gnosticism. You know, there's texts about Jesus and, you know, all these different things that people try to use to give an excuse for them to fall away from what this Holy Bible is telling us. The words, all scripture is inspired by God. It's God-breathed. and is profitable for doctrine, correction, and exhortation, and all these things. And we know that men of God speak as if they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So that's how we get our Bible today. A lot of people want to say, oh, your Bible is written by men and this and that. Well, these are men who had the Holy Spirit of God. They were God approved. The thing is that if we want to be hypocrites, we're going to go after commandments and doctrines of men, which is, you know, basically these men that, you know, want to go their own way. Because like, we got to look at it this way, right? It's either everything is written by men alone, or, you know, God has actually told us that he's spoken through men, through his essence, through the Holy Ghost, the Holy Spirit. You know, all these different things that people try to use to give an excuse for them to fall away from what this Holy Bible is telling us. The words God breathed. And this is the book of Revelation. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. Very interesting, because he's also the bread of life. So when we receive Jesus Christ in the Spirit, we're receiving the bread and the wine, the bread and the blood of Christ. We're receiving the full sacrifice. That's how I perceive this scripture. But you see the physical manifestation of it in the man Christ Jesus. And this is in the future, but you know, it's in the Spirit. And so if I move on to 1 Corinthians, it says, for as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body, being many, are one body, so also is Christ. Now if I keep going, now ye are the body of Christ, and members in particular. So we seem to be the bread of life as well. You are what you eat. Very interesting, right? So, you know, we are successors to our Lord. We are disciples. We are friends. We are family. We are sons of the Most High God. So we are ambassadors of the kingdom. And so for us, we need to be appreciative, and we need to understand what our calling is. And so what we want to do is we want to be a reasonable sacrifice, or we want to be a sacrifice, which is our reasonable service. And what does that mean? Well, I'm going to go further over here where it says in Ephesians, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Then I'm going to move on to James. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he has faith and have not works? Can faith save him? If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them that those things which are needful for the body, what doth it profit? James 1:22. Be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Let me clarify that Jesus Christ is the Word of God. He said, man will not live by bread alone, but by every word. So we're applying it. It's not just simply being hearers only and deceiving our own selves. So when you put all this together, it's very well structured, and you get to know the Spirit, the persona of who God is. Because these are the inspired words of the Holy Spirit. If I go further here in John, it is the Spirit that quickeneth. The flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. Matthew 24. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words will not pass away. So if you live by his words, you will not pass away. Because those words, you are what you eat. You're eating the bread of life. The bread of life is becoming you. You have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Christ covers and cleanses you of all your sin. So we continue in the faith, and we strive after our Lord. We strive after righteousness. This is the obedience. And then I move on to Corinthians. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. The last Adam was made a quickening spirit, Jesus Christ. Howbeit, that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. The first man is of the earth, earthly. The second man is the Lord from heaven. So in that same way, that's what the Lord was referencing to when he said the first is the last and the last is the first. And he even said that when I come, if you are able to see, you will be blind. And if you are blind, you will be able to see. So, you know, the humble will be exalted. assaulted and the prideful will be cut off. To me, this is not much more than a physical or symbolic representation. Man will not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. We are literally saved by grace through faith. Our works testify of that faith. So I'm basically trying to tell you that what we do is not earning, but it's representative. The bread and the wine is a physical and symbolic representation of receiving the sacrifice of Christ. Christ is the physical manifestation of the Word of God, the Word of God made flesh. Upon his coming, he who has claimed to be the bread of life, which is his body, he will wear a vesture dipped in blood, which represents his shed blood. So the bread of life is dipped in the blood of our atonement. Thus, when we receive the body, meaning his word, we receive the bread, flesh, and blood of Christ in the Spirit. And I would even go so far as to say we become it as he dwells in us, and we become translated into that kingdom inside of us, not of meat and drink, as he is the word of God, which is in a spiritual context meat and drink, but not physical. Being saved by grace through faith, this would be received through faith. So I would say justification is in the essence of Christ. The Spirit is and will always be the truth. His word says we are justified by faith, not by sight. The physical still has to do with sight. And so this is Passover all over again. And, you know, we're putting the blood of the Lamb on our doorpost, and he's delivering us. So I hope that this was very helpful to you, and God bless you, and I'm excited for the next one.
Shine, Jesus.